Here are two puzzles I like to give my students when I discuss the topic of arc length. First, suppose you're at a chasm with a 50 meter gap, and you're holding a rope tight across the 50 meter opening while your friend's holding onto the rope, trying to cross. Perhaps over a river filled with crocodiles. Your hands slip a little, and 1 meter of rope releases before you can stop it. Your friend, who is halfway across, drops some distance because of the extra rope. How far did your friend drop? You can think of the units in this problem as meters, feet, or crocodiles. The units really don't matter much. Here's the second puzzle. What if it's the same situation, but there's no one hanging on the rope? You let out 1 meter of slack, so now there are 51 meters of rope spanning a 50 meter gap. How far down does the middle of the rope fall? Without doing any calculations, what are your intuitive guesses to these two problems? Put them in the comments now, and then come back at the end of the video and reply with what you've learned. In calculus courses, students struggle a lot with arc length. First, our intuition's not good when judging lengths of curves. And second, it isn't easy to understand the formulas that are developed to calculate those lengths. We discuss both of these in this video. Every time I give one of these chasm problems to my students, they're always way off. They all guess a distance that is way smaller than the actual value. Many guess values lower than a meter. Some students even guess just a few centimeters. There is something counterintuitive about these distances. So let's figure out how far the drops are in these problems. The first one can be calculated using the Pythagorean theorem. We can draw in two right triangles. We know the old length of the rope was 50 meters, making these legs each 25 meters. And we know that the new length of the rope is 51 meters, making the hypotenuse of each 25.5 meters. Using the Pythagorean theorem to solve for the third side gives us the distance your friend dropped, very close to 5 meters. How close was your guess? Without a friend hanging on the middle of the rope will sag, but it won't fall as far. So now the distance from the middle will be less than 5 meters, but how much exactly? In order to answer this second question, we need to develop some reasoning first for how to find the length of a curve. There are some curves, like arcs of circles, where we already know how to measure the length. But how do we measure the length of an unknown curve? First, we can think about approximating the length by thinking of the curve as a chain of small straight line segments. If we chop up the curve into very small pieces, then each piece is approximately a straight line anyway. So we can measure the length of all those small segments and add them up to get an approximate length. If you've seen our video on integration already, you'll recognize that we are using the third conceptualization of integration, adding up tiny bits. At its heart, the integration process is to chop up the situation into small intervals, calculate the value in each subinterval, then add up the values across the whole interval. This is a conceptualization of integration that's often underdeveloped or quickly forgotten by students, and may be why students have a hard time understanding the arc length formula. Here we're going to break it down simply using the chop, multiply, and add technique. One way to think about this problem is to relate the length of each segment to the width of the interval. Notice that as the curve becomes steeper, it'll take a longer segment to get from one side of the interval to the other side. Each of these can be modeled as a triangle, and if we knew this length, we could again use the Pythagorean theorem to find the hypotenuse, and the length of the curve is approximately the sum of each hypotenuse of these tiny triangles. So what is this length? Well, we can use what we know about the steepness of a line. We often measure the steepness of the line by the slope of the line. Let's take a simple case and see if we can figure out the length of the hypotenuse. Here's a line of slope 5. What's the length of this line going from here to here? This leg is 1, and this leg is 5. How do I know it's 5? Because the slope tells me how much the y value changes with a 1 unit change in x, and we moved over 1 unit in the x direction. Or since slope is the ratio of the change in the y direction to the change in the x direction, then I can find the change in the y direction by multiplying the change in the x direction by the slope. The Pythagorean theorem gets us a value of a square root of 26. If we try a few more lines, we can start to see a pattern. Slope of 2 gives us a square root of 5. Slope of a negative 6 gives us a square root of 37. Each one is the square root of 1 plus the slope squared. What if we don't go over just 1 unit in the x direction? Well, we can multiply the square root expression by the length in the x direction, since these are all similar triangles to the first. So now we have an easy way to calculate the length of a straight line if we know the slope and the horizontal distance. This expression of the square root of 1 plus m squared can be thought of as a scaling value that stretches the length of the horizontal leg of a triangle to the length of the hypotenuse on a line with slope m. We can apply this to the problem of finding the length of a curve. If we approximate the curve into a lot of small segments and draw these triangles, then the length of each is the horizontal distance, which we call delta x, times the stretch factor that depends on the slope of the line. But if the slope isn't the same everywhere, how can we find the slope for all of these segments? Well, we can use the derivative. One way to interpret the derivative of a function at a point is the slope of the tangent line at that point. So we can use the derivative to estimate the slope of the hypotenuse line segments, and we can rewrite our scale factor as the square root of 1 plus dy dx squared, or f prime of x squared. All of that work allows us to actually write down the length of the curve as an integral, as long as we can take the derivative of the expression for the curve. Now, if we have a section of a curve, we can find the length. The thinking we've done here to develop the arc length formula is very different from the other two common conceptions of integration. We didn't use antiderivatives to understand the problem, and we didn't reason with any areas under a curve. This is one of the many applications for why the adding up tiny bits conception is important and powerful. Let's use what we've learned to do a simple problem first. Here's an edited image of a basketball shot. How far did this ball travel through the air during the shot? This is a relatively straightforward problem with the tools we've now developed. We start by modeling the path with an equation for the curve. In this case, we're using a parabola. We find our x values at the beginning and the end of the shot, so we know the bounds for our integral. Next, we calculate the derivative of the function for our curve and put it in our arc length scaling factor. Now we have the integral set up. We can have a computer do the calculation for us. Now let's apply what we've learned to the sagging rope problem next. Modeling this curve is not as straightforward as our basketball example. The first thing that complicates this problem is that hanging ropes and chains may look parabolic, but they are actually not. The most accurate model uses the hyperbolic cosine function. To keep things simple though, and since many viewers might not be familiar with the hyperbolic cosine function, I'm going to assume the curve is parabolic. It doesn't make a huge difference in this specific problem, and I'll give you the answer to both models later in the video. The other thing that complicates this problem is that here we know the arc length, but we need to find the equation of the curve first to find the question about the distance the rope sags. So this is backwards from the last problem. Since we're assuming the curve is a parabola, let's model the curve with the simplest parabola, y equals ax squared. If we change the value of a, then it changes the shape of the graph. We need to find the a that gives us a parabola that stretches 50 units and has a length of 51 units between those 50 units. Since the vertex of these parabolas are all at the origin, that means that the parabola must stretch from the x-coordinate negative 25 to 25. The arc length of the curve, which we can calculate using an integral, needs to be 51 units. This is an integral equation that an adventurous calculus student could try to solve by hand, but they'll get stuck trying to find the exact answer. Even using Wolfram Alpha, it only gets us so far. But there is another way to find a close value of a. We can use the good old guess and check method, and have Wolfram Alpha do the checking part for us. We simply change the value of a in our integral until we get the length of 51 units. When a is 0.007, we get a length of about 51.0029, which will be plenty close enough for us. So now we have a curve that is close to the sagging rope, and we can finally answer our question. The endpoints of our curve are at x equals a negative 25 and x equals 25, and the distance that they are above the x-axis is the same distance that the rope is sagging down. By evaluating our parabolic curve at x equals 25 or x equals a negative 25, we get a value of 4.375 units. In class, when we reach this final value, there's an audible gasp for many students. 1 foot or 1 meter of slack allows the rope to sag almost 4.5 feet or 4.5 meters in the middle. If we'd instead used the more accurate hyperbolic cosine model, we would have gotten 4.355 units, which is very close to our parabolic model. Even a slack of 1/3 of a unit, just 33 centimeters or 4 inches, drops the middle about 2.5 meters or 2.5 feet. My students are blown away that such little slack causes such a big difference in the sag. This has real implications. For example, long distance racers shouldn't worry about running out and around the pack on a straightaway or moving out just to keep some space because the extra distance they add to the run is almost negligible. In future videos, we'll show how this misunderstanding has real implications in other areas, from fast breaks in basketball to tying loads down on trailers. If you know of other situations where arc length comes into play or slack in straps or ropes is important, comment about them below to let us know. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.